fellow students of Jewish history. I hope you are doing well. I came across a fascinating discussion in the work of Guido Kish recently. He is a great legal historian who did some really heroic studies of the history of medieval Jewish law, that is, medieval Jewry law, how secular states passed laws regarding Jewish behavior and regulated Jewish behavior, and it has tremendous implications. I really don't know where he got the name Guido. That's really an unusual Jewish name, but nevertheless, he did some fantastic work, and I'm especially interested in a very controversial topic, that of the right of Jews to bear arms in early Ashkenaz. Now, I say this is controversial because it is very controversial, especially today in the United States of America. And I'm going to stay in my lane and only focus on the medieval period, although I do have personally very strong feelings about this subject. I'm not going to discuss them in this video. Let's just look specifically at the medieval period. So since he's a student of Jewry law, one of the things that really comes up first, in fact, it does head off one of the sections of his magnum opus on this topic, is were Jews allowed to bear arms? And if so, when and why? So specifically, we should understand that the way in which Jews lived as a tiny minority in these early European centers was that they had a relationship specifically with the king. It eventually was formed into a body of ideas that had classed the Jews as servae camarae regis, meaning servants of the royal chamber. They were specifically protected by the king from any depredations from nobles or peasants or abuse by the church, because the king saw them as an extremely valuable and profitable source of income. We'll talk more about that in other videos. At any rate, how does that apply, for example, to their bearing of arms? If they are so valuable to the king for their economic prowess and their tax base, should they be allowed to bear arms? Or does the opposition from the church dictate that they should not be allowed to bear arms? Also, armor is a sign of nobility. Armor is a sign of the upper classes. For example, peasants were not allowed generally to bear arms. And even when there was a situation where the peasants were called upon to defend the king's peace, they were required to do so with whatever they had at hand, specifically knives, shovels, pickaxes, things like that. They were generally not given formal weapons to go into battle, which must have been a really terrible thing. So what exactly was the situation with the Jews? Now, what Kish speaks about is absolutely fascinating. We should understand that most of these regulations regarding Jews were kind of like developed organically, and then usually after the fact, they were sealed in charters, which is when the king specifically dictates to the Jews or provides for the Jews a testament of what their privileges are. This is a really interesting kind of 14th century document. It's a little bit later, but let's start with this one here that shows the king returning the Torah scroll to the assembled Jews who came to greet him. The person who drew this, it's not clear whether or not he actually saw what was going on, because that doesn't look very much like a Torah scroll, and it's highly unlikely that they would be handling it, especially the Jews, with their bare hands. But at any rate, we see some useful things. We see the Jews on the right who are wearing the traditional Judenhut. This was an article of clothing that was required of the Jews by the Fourth Lateran Council of the Church in 1215. It's not exactly clear how well worn it was. There were other items like a Jewish badge and things like that. But at any rate, it appears very frequently in depictions of Jews in medieval art, which allows the viewer to understand what the story is, and it's helpful for us as historians of the Jewish people. So here are the Jews, and they have presented to the king their Torah scroll. The king has had a look at it, and he's giving it back to them as a sign of like, yes, this is fascinating. You are welcome to participate in our society, and so on. And this would be followed by a charter that specifically says, you know, what privileges they have. Now, specifically looking at the right to bear arms. If you have a look at this example, which comes from a legal document that Kish studied extensively called the Sachsenspiegel, the mirror of Sachsen, or it's a region in contemporary Germany. The reason why it's called a mirror is because this sort of law code is kind of reflecting what the legal practice is in those areas. It's one of the most important, really crucial 13th century documents that we have to give us a sense of how people behaved in medieval Germany. And what's especially nice about this is that it comes with like illustrations, with kind of cartoonish illustrations of the law code. So illiterates, including possibly the king, can actually look at it and understand what's going on. So here, this particular picture, which is recorded in a Sachsenspiegel miniature, shows the king on the right, with that special kind of three-pointed crown, and he's smiling, and he is instructing the people of his domain, which include, not sure who that guy on the right is with that funny hat, but next to him in a dark tunic is clearly a clergyman with a tonsure, the distinctive Christian haircut. And then there are two women behind him, which implies sort of like a collective of women. And then separated for modesty is a Jew. And all of them are included within the king's peace. And what puts them together in common is that they are considered defenseless and not expected to defend themselves, right? The clergy and women, and certainly the Jew as well, not expected to defend themselves. They will, don't worry, we got your back. We're going to defend you as part of your participation in society. Now, does that really hold true? Like, what if, for example, if they're attacked en masse? It appears from other aspects of the Sachsenspiegel that Jews were also called upon to participate in public defense. Here's an example where a group of men are gathered together and given arms in order to protect the country from an attack. And as you can see, among the group of men on the far left is in fact the Jew wearing the Judenhut, and he's also included in the public defense. And in fact, we have some really interesting Jewish documents, like the Or Zeruah, for example, speaks about Jews serving as, guarding the city walls, even on Shabbat, even carrying weapons on Shabbat for that purpose and so on. So Jews were definitely involved, at least in the early centuries, before the High Middle Ages really got underway, that Jews were involved in public defense and were also considered able to bear arms. And in fact, here's my favorite picture. This is an early Sachsenspiegel. And as you can see, there is a priest on the left riding a very weird looking horse. And he's prominently carrying a sword. It looks like he's got spurs on too. And right behind him is the Jew, as if to say, clergy and Jews are in fact allowed to bear arms. Now, we have a lot of examples of this all the way up through the 13th century, but around that time in the 13th century, particularly when Innocent III becomes Pope, we begin to see this privilege eroded steadily. We know that Jews were able to defend themselves with arms even during the First Crusade of 1096, when there were a lot of massacres in the region, but the ability of Jews to bear arms was slowly degraded over the centuries afterwards, with frequent citations later of Jews not being allowed to carry arms even when they were traveling on business, which was an especially dangerous enterprise. So this is a fascinating kind of way of looking at the degradation of the status of the Jew as the higher Middle Ages wore on. But as I said at the beginning of this video, it's really hard to make any kind of generalization from this medieval story to the contemporary American situation. There's so many different factors at play, so many different variables. I'm really not comfortable with the thought that someone would look at this and say, oh, so therefore this particular noxious attitude is acceptable in contemporary American society. But like I said, I'm going to stay in my lane. I'm a historian. I talk about the past. I'm really excited to share these videos with you as I prepare my research for traveling to Europe again with Kosher Riverboat Cruises. If you can join us, it will be fantastic to be able to explore these places together. And if not, I hope that you'll enjoy these videos. Thank you very much for watching.